Amos chapter 3. And we'll read the first few verses of scripture there in Amos chapter 3. Amos chapter 3, verse 1. Bible says in Amos 3, verse 1, "Hear this word that the Lord hath spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt, saying, You only have I known of all the families of the earth. Therefore I will punish you for all your iniquities. Can two walk together except they be agreed? Will a lion roar in the forest when he hath no prey? Will a young lion cry out of his den? If he have taken nothing, can a bird fall in a snare upon the earth where no gain is for him? Shall one take up a snare from the earth and have taken nothing at all? Shall a trumpet be blown in the city and the people not be afraid? Shall there be evil in a city and the Lord hath not done it? Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants, the prophets." Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for your word. Thank you for the message of our brother Stevenson, dear God. And Father, we ask, Lord, that you would bless the preaching of your word now. I realize I'm absolutely nothing without you. And Lord, if there's a lost soul here today, we pray that you might work in their heart and life. And Father, save them before it's everlasting too late. And God, we pray for your people, Lord, that you would help us to live for you. And Lord, help us to draw closer to you, Lord, in these last days. We know we're just here in the first week of the new year, and help us, God, to live for you, God, like we never have before. Father, we pray in Jesus' name and amen.
Amen.
Here in Amos chapter 3, God says here that he has a controversy with the whole family of Jacob. And he says here in verse 2, "You only have I known of all the families of the earth, therefore I will punish you for all your iniquities." Verse 3, I want to preach from. He says, "Can two walk together except they be agreed?" You know, it's hard in a marriage if they're not agreed, a husband and wife. It's kind of hard for them to walk together unless they're agreed. And it applies to a marriage situation. It also applies to a Christian and God walking together. And I want to take verse 3 where he says, "Can two walk together except they be agreed?" And I want to preach a message. Do you love what God loves? Do you love what God loves? One of the problems we have in America today is that a lot of professing Christians simply don't love what God loves. And I went through the Bible and I found out some things that God loves, and these are not necessarily in chronological order of importance. But I want to say, first of all, do you love what God loves? When two people meet and do nothing but quarrel as they walk together, what happens? They come to a parting of the ways. And that's what happens between, not only in a marriage situation, but it happens between a Christian and the Lord. And do you love what God loves? First of all, number one, I want to say this, that God loves Israel. God loves Israel. There's been a lot in the news lately about Israel. And 1 Kings 10 verse 9 says, "Because the Lord loved Israel forever." In 2 Chronicles 9, verse 8, the Bible says, "Because thy God loved Israel to establish them forever." In Genesis 12, verses 1 to 3, God called Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees for a better land that God would give him. God made an unconditional covenant with Abraham, and that promise is just as good today as it was back in Genesis 12, verses 1 to 3. He said, "I'll bless them that bless thee and curse him that curseth thee." There is nothing anywhere in the Bible that disannuls this covenant. There's nothing in the New Testament that says this covenant was disannulled at Calvary. This covenant of God giving the land of Canaan to Abraham was an everlasting covenant, according to Genesis 17, verses 7 and 8, and was given to Abraham and his seed. This is the area that people call Palestine today. the Arabs lay claim to this land because they too are descendants of Abraham through Ishmael. But God was careful to cover this issue as well, because in Genesis 17, verses 18 to 21, Isaac, not Ishmael, was chosen of God to receive the blessing. The land grant itself extends west to the river of Egypt and east to the Euphrates in Genesis 15, 18 to 21. So while the United Nations and the news media and the Palestinian Authority and the Pope and President Barack Obama and John Kerry and others are losing sleep over Israel's occupied territories, God is preparing to have the last laugh by letting Israel occupy the entire territory. I don't care what Obama and Kerry signed a couple weeks ago as he slapped Israel right across the face before he leaves office here in a few days. Israel occupies that entire territory. In other words, the Gaza Strip and the West Bank will seem like nothing when Israel finally possesses all of the occupied territories, plus parts of Jordan, Syria, Iraq, and Saudi Arabia. Zechariah 2:8 says, "For he that toucheth you," talking about Israel, "toucheth the apple of his eye." You better pray this country doesn't go against Israel. I'm talking about full flesh. Eventually, we will go against Israel, because when the Lord comes back at the Battle of Armageddon, he wipes out all the nations, because all the nations eventually turn against Israel. And that includes the United States. Now, I don't know under what administration that's going to happen. It happened a little bit in the last 8 years. We're told to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee, Psalms 122, verse 6. I want to say God loves Israel. Number two, God loves Jesus Christ. John 3:35, the Father loveth the Son and hath given all things into his hand. John 5:20, for the Father loveth the Son and showeth him all things that himself doeth. John 14:21, he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. John 15:9, as the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. What is one of the reasons God loves Jesus Christ? Because he laid down his life voluntarily on the cross. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life. I have power to lay it down. I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father, in John 10, verses 17 and 18. Well, I'm glad Jesus went to the cross. Amen. Dr. Howard Kelly, the famous Christian physician, once said that the first recorded words of our Lord were, "Wist ye not that I must be about my Father's business," in Luke 2:49. And his last words were, "It is finished," in John 19:30. We need to be about our Father's business. So at the end of our life, we can say, "It's finished, Lord. I've done what you've called me to do and what I've told you to do." Amen. You think about old Methuselah. Old Methuselah, he lived for almost 1,000 years, 969 years old when he died. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine having a heart and a liver and kidneys and organs in your body that live almost 1,000 years? But he never said a word worth putting down in the Bible. He lived for almost 10 centuries and never did a single act worth reporting. Think about that. I'm going to say that again. Old Methuselah lived for almost 1,000 years and never said a word worth putting down in the Bible. He lived for almost 10 centuries and never did a single act worth reporting. He vegetated like a tree that wasn't living. Jesus Christ was only here for 33 and a half years of public life, and his name has gone through the earth, filled heaven with its rays, and its deeds shall be spoken of throughout the ages of eternity. 33 and a half years. What a Savior. You know what Napoleon said about Jesus Christ? Napoleon said, I know men, and I tell you that Jesus Christ is not just a man. Everything about him amazes me. Napoleon said that his spirit overawes me and his will confounds me. There's no possible comparison between him and any other being in the world. His birth, the history of his life, the profoundness of his doctrine, his gospel, his march across the ages, all these are to me a wonder, an insoluble mystery. He said this, Alexander the Great, Caesar, Charlemagne, and I, Napoleon, founded empires. But on what did the creations of our genius rest? He said it rested on force. On force. He said Jesus Christ alone founded his empire on love. And at this hour, he said millions would die for him. He said, I'm at St. Helena. It's a British island in the South Atlantic, Napoleon's place of exile. He said, I'm at St. Helena. I die before my time. Him whom the world called the great Napoleon. What an abyss between my deep misery and the eternal reign of Christ, which is proclaimed, loved, adored, and which is extending all over the earth. Napoleon said that about our Savior. What a Savior. Do you love Jesus Christ? You know, traveling around the country for years and preaching and so forth, a lot of the times I go into church, and a pastor, you know, I get to the church, you know, or fly in or drive in or whatever, and we'll go out and, you know, get something to eat the first night there, and the pastor and I be sitting there. This don't happen in every church, but in a lot of churches. And a pastor will look, I can't tell you the number of times a pastor has looked at me and said, Brother Kogel, can I ask you a question? I said, go ahead. He said, how do I get my people to fall in love with Jesus Christ? And I look at him and say, beats me. I don't know. I don't know how. I see people get saved and they grab a hold of this thing and man, they go with it. They grow in the Lord and they just, you know, they're on fire for God and they want to do right, their heart's open. And then you see some people that make a profession of faith. You can't find them with the FBI, the CIA, the KGB, a magnifying glass, and the SWAT team. And they profess to be saved, but they don't really seem to have an interest in spiritual things. They don't really seem to have an interest in following God and the things of God. Boy, I'm glad when I got saved, God put a love down in my heart for Jesus Christ. Amen? God loves Israel. He loves Jesus Christ. Number three, God loves souls or sinners, the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. Romans 5:8. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. When Jesus Christ was dealing with an unsaved rich young ruler in Mark 10:21, it said, then Jesus, beholding him, loved him and said unto him, one thing thou lackest, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come take up the cross and follow me. And it says about that young man in verse 22, and he was sad at that saying and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. The apostate religious, political, and ecumenical Roman system in the tribulation called Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth, will be characterized by 28 things mentioned in Revelation 18, verse 12 and 13. And the last on the list is the souls of man. But that's true of a lot of churches today. I mean, you don't have to wait till Revelation 17 and 18, the tribulation, the apostate, ecumenical Roman church and so forth. There's churches like that today. Do you love the souls of mankind? Do you pray earnestly for them? Do you witness to them? Are you an influence in anybody else's life? Do you pass out a tract? You ought to say, Lord, this year I want to pass out more tracts. Wouldn't that be good if we'd all say, Lord, help me to be more of a witness. Help me to pass out more tracts this year than I ever have before. Amen. You know, we Bible believers sometimes think we got to preach an hour sermon to everybody and talk to them about how many hairs the Antichrist has on his left toenail during the last half of the tribulation. You don't have to do that. You don't have to show how much Bible you know. Just, I mean, if they want to hear it, fine, but most people don't. Just hand them out a tract. Just hand them a gospel tract. And say, hey, come on out to church. That little tracker will tell you how you can know for sure if you died, you go to heaven. Come on out. How long will that take? 8 seconds? You say, well, I'm afraid they'll get mad at me. Or who cares? Just have the right spirit when you do it. Amen? I mean, God loves souls. God loves. Why do you think there are men and women? There are people. There are husbands. Why, there's husbands. There's men in this country in the last, 100 years. I mean, beyond that. But I mean, I know missionaries. I know missionaries that have quit good jobs. I mean, they had retirement. They had benefits. They made great money. Some of them. There's ones flashing in my face right now, in my mind right now. Different missionaries, and. I know one missionary man, he made a caboodle's bunch of money. And he quit his job, all those benefits. His mom and dad and his wife's mom and dad thought he was nuts. And they didn't want him to go to the mission field and take their grandkids to cross the water and the ocean and everything else. And bucked up against it at first and everything. And then they kind of realized it was God and everything. But at first they didn't like it. I mean, why does God have people do that? Why does God have people quit their jobs or go here or go there and sacrifice and so forth? Because there's lost souls out there. Number four. This is the one I want to get to. God loves the church. Ephesians 5:25. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Matthew 16:18, Jesus said to Peter, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I want to ask you tonight, do you love the church? Are you a member of a Bible-believing, Bible-preaching and teaching church? Do you pray for your pastor and other people in the church? Do you attend the church services whenever you're able to? Do you give tithes and offerings to help support your church financially? Are you involved in some way in your church? You know, a lot of people, they get a little quiet. You know what I heard a preacher say here a while back? He said, you ever notice? I never even thought about it until he said it. He said, you ever notice the offering time is the quietest time in our churches? And I thought, he's right. Most of the churches I've been in, Bible talks about, God loveth a cheerful giver. Somebody said those words over there mean hilarious and all this. I don't know about all that. But all I know is that where's all the hilariousness at? Yeah. Amen? You know, Jack Wood, when he had camp meetings, in Houston, Texas years ago, he told me this. I preached for him for several years there. He told me, he said, preacher, he said, there's a lot of times, he said, I'll start my meeting out by taking up an offering. Whoa! You say, I don't think I'll talk. You say, but you say a lot of these preachers on television, they're fakers and they're charismatic liars and they try to get people's money. Hey, that ain't me. You think because we got fakers and liars talking about stuff that I'm going to shy away from it and not preach on it? What if the fakers and liars and charismaniacs on the TV and trying to get everybody's money. What if they start emphasizing being born again? Does that mean I'm going to shy away from preaching that you got to be born again? No way, honey.
I think I told my wife the other day, I said, you realize how much of our income we give every month, approximately every month?
Tithes, offerings, missions, and radio. Radio is part of missions, but separate though in my situation. But I said, you know how much we're giving? You know what percentage of income we're given every month? Tithes, offerings, missions, and radio. And I told her the percentage and approximately how much we give. She about fell off her chair. She said, how are we giving that much? I said, by faith, honey. You say, I don't think you ought to talk about giving. Oh, I do. I do. If God don't have your pocketbook, he don't have you. God loves the church. Some stay home because it's cold, and some because they're hot, some because they're getting old, and some because they're not. Alas, alas, our excuses grow to drive our thoughts from God and turn us from the house of prayer to the place our fathers trod. On Sunday morning years ago, September 27th, 1959, President Eisenhower invited the Russian leader Khrushchev to accompany him to a worship service at Gettysburg Presbyterian Church here in America. The communist leader declined, and Eisenhower went without him. I'm not trying to be a smart aleck, but since I've been saved in the ministry, I've heard Christians say, Pastor, we couldn't come Sunday. We had some visitors from out of town. We had some people we haven't seen for years, and they came, and so we stayed home Sunday morning and Sunday night or one of the services. Why? Well, I haven't seen them in a long time, preacher. You quit being a fanatic. You know what I would say? I would say, now, on Sunday mornings, we go to church, and you're welcome to go with us. But if you don't want to go, that's fine. You stay here. We'll be coming back. And we'll see you when we get back. We'll be back a couple hours, and they can do without you for a couple hours, can't they? What's hard about that? You say, that's fanatical Christianity. No, that's biblical Christianity. You have to be a smart aleck. You say, hey, we go to church Sunday morning. We go to church Sunday night. We go to church Wednesday night whenever you have your service. We go to church. That's what we do around here. We go to church. We're not trying to be mean about it. We don't think we're better than anybody else. We just go to church. You're welcome to go with us. I don't think we're going to go. Okay, that's fine. But we'll be back in a couple hours. We'll see you. What's wrong with that? God loves the church. Gave himself for it. I want to say this. God not only loves the church, but I'm attaching this to it. God loves your pastor. God loves your pastor. You say, he don't love him more than anybody else. No, he doesn't. But he loves your pastor. We got several pastors in here. I'm not going to name names. I'll leave somebody out. But you ought to thank God for your pastor. Amen. I'm going to tell you what. The Bible believers are a dying breed. There are guys that are compromising all over this country. They're compromising in two basic areas. Music and the Bible. Now they're compromising on like some other little things in the church, you know, going on. But it's basically those things. I mean, a lot of them, you know, they're letting down on their dress code and things like that. These people, I'm not trying to get off on all this stuff, but I want to tell you something. I think when you come to the house of the Lord, I've had people say, well, this is all I've got to wear. And if that's all you got to wear, then come. But you know what I found out? When people go to a wedding or a funeral, they usually dress up, especially a funeral. You wouldn't believe some of the things I've seen people wear in the house of God. Back, I don't know how it is around here. They look like they're going to a picnic. About half naked. That's an abomination in the sight of God. Get some stinking clothes on. God loves your pastor. Now, I want you to turn your Bibles. I can quote it, but I'm not going to quote it. I want you to read it. I want you to turn your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I'm going to show you something. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Some of you like it. Some of you probably won't like it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And we're going to see what God says about a pastor. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 12 and 13. I'm reading from the King James Bible. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 12. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you. Folks, pastoring, being a pastor is labor. You say, he's not digging ditches. It's spiritual labor. It's mental labor. He is in a warfare that most people know nothing about. Know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord. That preacher, that pastor is over you spiritually. The spiritual rulership is spiritual only. And admonish you and to esteem them very highly. That isn't my words. Very highly in love for their work's sake. Now, what I'm about to say, your pastor, my brother Kim, and some of these other pastors probably won't like it, but I'm going to say it anyways. We don't worship them, but this Bible that we profess to believe says to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. When my wife and I were members of Tri-County Church down in Georgia, down there, Dr. Homer Smith was the pastor. We were members down there for 8 years. I'm not saying that you have to do this. I'm not saying that. But I'm going to tell you what we did. I mean, besides the fact of showing our pastor we love him by saying, that's a great message, preacher. We appreciate that message. You know, God bless you. We're praying for you. You know, and not starting trouble in the church with our mouth. And things like that. Besides those types of things, showing him that we love him. I told my wife, I said, you know what we're going to do? We're going to find out. We found out as soon as we got there, when the pastor's birthday was, when his wife's birthday was, his wife's not called to preach. Hey, dummy, they're both one. Do you know how many men are out of the ministry today because their wives said, I don't want nothing to do with it. I've had it. What's he going to do? They're one. We found out when Brother Homer Smith's birthday was. We found out when his wife, Miss Ellie's birthday was. And we found out when their anniversary was. You say, what'd you do? We didn't go out and buy him $1 million gift. But they loved to go eat here and there. I know where Brother Homer liked to go eat. He liked to eat. We went and got him little gift certificates. $25, $50. You say, I can't afford that. You spend more money on that on dog food and cat food and parakeet food. Amen? We do what we want to do with our money, folks. I wasn't born last night. I've been watching Christians for almost 40 years now. Make excuses just about everything. So every year on his birthday, we got him a little gift certificate. Nothing big. I mean, it wasn't a big $1 million thing. Just a little token of appreciation. To esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. According to the King James Bible. That's what we did. And when her birthday came, we did the same thing for her. I gave it to him on his birthday. My wife gave it to her, the pastor's wife. And on their anniversary, I gave it to him. You say, you did that every year? Every year. Wasn't a big deal. I'm not saying that to brag. It ain't nothing to brag about. It's just a little token of appreciation. I didn't know what else to do, really do for him. We didn't have, you know, a lot of money and stuff. I had five kids, man, trying to raise five kids in full-time evangelism. God loves the church. And he loves that pastor. And he loves the pastor's wife. You ought to thank God for your pastor. All these pastors here. Like I said, I don't want to name all of them because I'll leave somebody out. But several pastors here and their wives. You ought to thank God for them. That they're still staying by the stuff. Going through trials and tribulations and discouraging times and valleys. And still staying in there and hanging in there. You ought to thank God for them, folks, honestly. Jeremiah 3:15, and I'll give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. Concerning Pastor Kim, I think here in a couple months, in March, won't you be, will you be celebrating 20 years? Will you come out here? March of 97? 20 years in a church. That's a great accomplishment.
You say, we don't give glory to man, preacher. We give glory to God.
You pious thing, you. You're so spiritual. God loves the church. He loves that pastor and loves that pastor's wife. You know, I heard a preacher preach years ago. I never heard a message like it in my life. Are you ready? I've never heard a message like it since. He preached a message. He was in a camp meeting. A bunch of preachers there and their wives. The place was packed. He preached on the most forgotten person in the church. I give you a guess who it was. Bingo! The pastor's wife. That's what he preached. It's a great message. Our message. You say, where did he get verses at in the Bible for that? Oh, he got them. And he didn't use new versions either. It's great. I was amening. Some people look like he's madder than a hornet. I remember Dr. Ruckman saying when he pastored as a single man for 12 years, right. Brent Baptist Church, Pensacola. I've heard him say it on tapes 40 years ago. He said, I was at a tremendous disadvantage as a pastor, pastoring for 12 years without a wife. Right. If you can't figure that out why, then I don't know what to tell you. Yeah. Got to have a wife. Got to have a helpmeet. Yeah. Somebody's going to be right there with him. God loves the church. Turn to, if you would, to Hebrews 13. Hebrews chapter 13. You ought to thank God for your pastor, his wife. You got Brother Kim and Sister Diane, Brother and Sister Shribe here in this church. Brother Shribe's dad was pastored here for years and years. Preacher, how long did you say you pastored here? 44 years. Thank God for that. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Let's Amen. 44 years. Praise the Lord. And the work is carrying on for the glory of God. Amen. Thank God. And then you got other pastors here. You ought to thank God for them. There's discouraging times. The devil fights. I know, because I've been in this for a little bit of time. The devil comes against your mind about different things. And you know, what about this? And what are you going to do about this? And this one don't like this one. And this one's fussing with this one. And there's a personality clash with the young people. And these kids don't like this kids. And this one don't like, this one's jealous of this one. And what are you going to do about this? And these women don't like this woman. And this man don't like that man. Try it. You'll like it. You'll be crazy like us. No, it's a blessing. It's a blessing going crazy. No, I'm just kidding. I thank God God's called me to preach. I love the ministry. I love people. It's just part of it. I hear preachers say, I love everything about the ministry except people. That's a stupid thing to say. That's what the ministry is. People. People got problems. They got trials. They got things they want to talk about sometimes. Hebrews 13, verse 7. Hebrews 13, 7. Remember them which have the rule over you. There's that spiritual rulership. Who have spoken unto you the word of God. Whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. Look down here at verse 17. Verse 17. Obey them that have the rule over you. See that over you? Verse 7 says, remember them which have the rule over you. Verse 17, obey them that have the rule over you. And submit yourselves, for they watch for your soul. Folks, your pastor watches for your soul. I mean, you're not here a couple services in a row, and the pastor, if he's got any heart at all, he's thinking, I wonder where so-and-so was. Yeah. Then they're thinking, the devil says, it's something you preached. They're mad at you. There's something you said. You didn't shake their hand. You walked right by them. Something you preached at. I mean, all these things come in their mind. It's a constant bombardment, and the devil fights that pastor and his wife constantly. I'm thinking, well, did I say something? I don't think I said anything to them wrong. I wonder why they're not here. I wonder why they're... For they watch for your souls as they that must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief. For that's unprofitable for you. Verse 24. Salute all them that have the rule over you. And all the saints, they of Italy salute you. Grace be with you all. Amen. Notice over you is mentioned in verse 24, verse 17, and verse 7 in this chapter. Over you, over you, over you. Now listen to this. You'll never be over until you learn to be under. You will never, God will never really put you in a place of leadership. You'll never be over until you learn to be under. You'll never have authority until you learn to be under authority. God loves the church. He loves that pastor and the pastor's wife. When did you come out here in March of 97? I was in his house. I preach in New Hampshire. I preach here every year. And I was in his house, and he fed me. What was that you fed me? Kimchi. What is it called? Kimchi. Fed me kimchi. And that was the first time I met you, I think, wasn't it? And the boys were just little, 2 or 3 years old. Just little, tiny little boys. Where are they at? There they are. Where's he at? Young. It's just little tykes. And nice home. I don't want him to listen to this, but it was a nice home. You say, what did he do? He sold it. A certified public accountant, quit his job. And come out here and started a church.
You say, well, that ain't no big deal. He's just doing what God told him to do, bless God.
You try it.
You say, I would if God called me.
Are you? Are you doing what God called you to do? Been here 20 years. I know. He don't have to say one word. I know. There's been discouraging times for him and Sister Diane. There was something, wasn't there something right since the first year? You thought he was going to have a place to meet or something and didn't work out or something. I forget what the deal was there. I forget back years ago. I mean, just been a lot of things. You don't build a work and do something for God like this and the devil not smack you around. You're dealing with souls. Souls. Eternal destinations. Young people. Marriages. People's lives. It's a warfare. Spiritual warfare. You ought to thank God for all these pastors in here and their wives. I tell you what, I just can't get off this point. I don't know what it is, man, but God loves the church. And people are flipping about the church today in America. God loves that pastor. You know when Moses, when the people rose up against Moses there in Exodus and Numbers, in the book of Numbers, Moses wasn't perfect. But when the people and Korah and Abiram and all those rebels, when they rose up against Moses there, you know what God was going to do? You say God probably was going to spank them. Bad little boys and girls. No. God was going to kill them. God took Moses' side. He loved that leader. You say, well, Moses wasn't perfect. No, and I'm not saying there aren't preachers that people need to leave their church because they're not Bible believers. They quit believing the King James. They're false doctrine. They mess up morally or whatever it is. I'm not saying there's never a reason to leave a church. But I'm just saying you got a good pastor and pastor's wife. You ought to thank God. And we got them all over this congregation. Pastors sitting in their wives. I'm not saying that to suck up to nobody. I'm not saying that to politic. I don't have to politic. Yeah. I'm just telling you, that's the way it is. God loves, esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. So, Brother Homer, here. You and Miss Ellie, go out and get you something to eat. Just a little gift certificate, $25, $50. You know? Her birthday, here's something for you. Appreciate you. You don't have to go out and make a big deal and scream, slobber all over them and hug them and kiss them for an hour and all that. You don't have to do that. Just go up and say, here. Matter of fact, you don't have to do it in front of other people. Just, hey, I want to give you this. Be a blessing to you. I love you. Love you, preacher. Love you, sister. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? As we have therefore opportunity, Galatians 6:10, you might not always have the opportunity. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially they who are of the household of faith. Especially to the Christians. Especially to a pastor and his wife. They're quitting by the dozens. All over the country. There's churches all, I mean, there's in the last, and I'd say in the last 7 or 8 years, I could have gone to 15, 20 different churches if I wanted to, if I felt like it was God's will. Brother Kogel,
You know, are you interested in coming to our church? You know of anybody that take this church? And this, what, you say, where's that? Different around the country, different places, different states. Our pastor left, or our pastor fell, or our pastor and his wife are getting a divorce, or, you know, she don't want nothing to do with the ministry no more. He's gone nutso, wacko, or something, you know, or something. Yeah. 20 years. Boy, I wonder what God's going to do here in the next 20 years. Woo! Praise God. Isn't that a blessing?
Yes, sir.
And then, let me give you this quickly. God loves the saints of God. John 13:1, the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. I thank God for the love of God I got in my hearts towards my brothers and sisters in Christ. I love my brothers. I love you. I don't even know a lot of you. But I feel closer to you than I do my own family members that are lost.
Amen.
I do. I'm not just saying that. I do.
Right.
You say, what do you mean, preacher? You only come out here once a year. Come on. I do.
Right.
There's just something about Christian people that have Jesus in their hearts.
Right.
You love the saints of God? You say, I can't stand brother so-and-so. I can't stand sister so-and-so. They rub me the wrong way. I like to smack them upside the face. I bet God like to smack me upside the face sometimes. I'll tell you that right now. I thank God he don't.
Yeah.
Number six, God loves righteousness.
Yeah.
Hebrews 1:9, thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Psalms 11:7, for the righteous Lord loveth righteousness. Psalms 45:7, thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. God loves righteousness. Does America love righteousness? Our country doesn't love righteousness. It voted to get drunk in 1933. This country voted to repeal prohibition in 33. That's what, 84 years ago. This country voted 84 years ago to get drunk. You know how many people have been slaughtered out in the highways because of a drunk driver just in the past 84 years? You know how many women, wives have been beaten by a drunk husband? And killed even, or murdered, or hurt badly. Thrown across the room and knocked their head up against the dresser or whatever because of a drunk husband. Kids that have been beaten and abused physically by a drunk dad or stepdad or somebody. This country voted 84 years ago to get drunk. Now we're voting to get high on reefer. State by state. Eventually, next 5 or 10 years, probably the whole country.
Right.
So let's see. The Supreme Court ruled that sodomites can get married last summer, year ago summer. And then we got voted 84 years ago to get drunk. Now we're voting to get high.
Right.
I'm telling you. You better try to witness and get as many people saved as you can, because the Lord's coming back. This stuff with Israel and Russia and China and North Korea. The leader over there in North Korea, how old is he? 30 years old? 31. Just a baby sitting over there smiling about nuclear. He's got nuclear. I don't know what's going to happen. Better stay close to the Lord. Try to get somebody saved. Because the pot, as Brother Stevenson, there's death in the pot. The pot's brewing.
Yeah.
It's stirring. All these countries.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, sir.
After 8 years, the world's in a mess. That's what you get when you have a community organizer. It's what you get. Voted him in twice, America. That's what you get. Be like voting me in as president. I wouldn't know what I'm doing as a president. I have no business being president.
Now we're voting to get high on marijuana and other drugs. This country loves adultery, fornication, filthy TV programs, filthy trash on the internet, homosexuality, lesbianism, transgender. That'd be a two-hour thing right there. Let me tell you something. I read something in a magazine, and I don't know. I want to say this. Somebody's going to get mad when I say this, but you know what they say a lot of that junk is? They're not saying it's true of every single woman and every single mother, but they're saying some of that transgender junk, when a little boy says, "Mommy, I want to be a little girl. Can I play with doll babies and be a little girl?" They're saying that a lot of mothers are encouraging it in America. They think it's cute. Mommy thinks it's cute. Mommy needs a good spanking. A little boy says, "I want to be a little girl." And a little girl says, "I want to be a boy. Can I be a boy?" "No, you can't be a boy. You're a little girl."
Amen.
Say, "Honey, now listen. You say it and then you change the subject real quick. But I want to be..." A lot of this is encouraged by the school system. These left-wing and television, left-wing, God-hating reprobates, and the news media and television and schools and everything else. And these, I'm going to tell you what, I'll be, in April 11th, I'll be 60 years old. And in almost 60 years of living on this earth, I have never had a desire to be a woman.
Thank God.
I've never had a desire. There's never been a thought in my head say, "I think I'm going to change myself. I think I want to be a woman. Hey, I think that'd be neat." I'm not trying to be mean, but to go there has to be something wrong.
Yes, sir.
I mean, to go there in your mind and to really want to do that, I'm saying, and believe it, and dwelling on that, and wanting to do that, and doing that, something wrong up here.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Need counseling. Need some kind of counseling.
Yeah.
You say, "I don't think you ought to say that." Somebody's got to say something.
Yeah.
In this country. When that little boy or little girl wants to be, a woman told me here, there in Ohio, she was in one of these places that you work out, you know, she's trying to lose some weight, and she's, it's a gym thing, you pay a membership thing here to go in there, and she was in the restroom, and in the stall there, and she was changing, getting in her clothes there to go out there and work out and get on the treadmill and do all this stuff, you know, and she was and she looked down in the next stall, and she seen the person's feet. She told me this with her own mouth. She's a Christian woman. And she said, "I thought, man, that woman's got..." I thought to myself, "Man, that woman's got big feet." And she said, "I got out of the stall, and I went over to the mirror and was putting my hair up, getting ready to go out there and do some exercises and stuff. And she said, this person come out, and it was a man dressed as a woman. And she immediately went out of there as fast as she could, got out of there and went to the manager, supervisor of the place, the owner, I forget, something like that, and the head guy there. And she said, "Sir, I was just in the restroom." She said, "A guy was in there in the next stall next to me, and he come out, and he's a man dressed as a woman." And he said, "Ma'am, there's nothing we can do about it. We have to go on what is on their driver's license, not their birth certificate." That's why that governor lost in North Carolina. Barely lost. The reason he lost is because outside people, the left-wing, liberal, God-hating reprobates come in there and put a bunch of money into that state of North Carolina to get that guy, Rory McCrory, whatever his name is, the governor, out of that state there, and he barely lost to that Democrat. Can you believe we're in a place in America where we are talking about letting boys and men go into women's restrooms and women and girls go into men's restrooms? Can you believe that we are even discussing such a thing as that? And this president is all for it that we have right now. That is wicked. Absolutely wicked. And then quickly, let me give you this real quick. God loves judgment. Isaiah 61:8, for I, the Lord, love judgment. Psalms 37:28, for the Lord loveth judgment. We could see the judgment of God being poured out on America in the last 20 years by the weather. One of the ways God brings judgment upon a nation when they spit in his face and sin is through the weather. Have you noticed in some parts of the country, there's too much water? Flooding. In other parts, like out here, you've had out in the western half, you've had thousands and tens of thousands of acres in the states out here burned up. That's part of the judgment of God. And then you get into Florida and they have tornadoes and hurricanes and everything else. Different parts of the country have different things. That's what God does. That's what he did to Israel in the Old Testament. One of the things God does is he chastises nations through the weather. Because what happens is it hurts the farming. And what happens is those fruits and vegetables and crops and everything are totally obliterated and everything. And so when you go to the grocery store and buy your groceries, everything costs an arm and a leg. That's part of the judgment of God on a nation that's spit in his face. Judgment. Floods, drought, fires, tornadoes, hurricanes, mudslides, typhoons, diseases, volcanoes, everything. God loves judgment. A woman who was called to jury duty told the presiding judge that she was not qualified to serve because she did not believe in capital punishment. The judge says, "You don't understand, ma'am. This is a civil case involving a man who spent $5,000 of his wife's money on gambling and other women." To which the woman replied eagerly, "I'll be happy to serve, Your Honor, and I've changed my mind about capital punishment too." Praise God, amen. Can two walk together except they be agreed? God loves Israel. He loves Jesus Christ. He loves souls. He loves the church. And he loves the pastor of the church, these pastors, and their wives. Because there's sacrifice on that wife's part too. It isn't just him. I'd like to preach about an hour on that right there. I really would. I'd like to just nail that thing good right tonight, but I can't. I got to stop. God loves the Word of God, preaching. We could go all night about that, preaching in the Word of God, and you know, and he's magnified his Word. And so God loves the saints of God. God loves righteousness, and God loves judgment. Let's love the things that God loves, folks. Amen.